Good afternoon to all the participants. I welcome you all to the fifth day of this webinar, the lecture series on biotechnology concepts to practice. To introduce today's speaker, I request the organizing secretary, Dr. R. Thyagarajan, to say a few words and introduce the speaker to us. Thyagarajan, sir.
Thank you, sir. So, good afternoon, everyone present here. So today we are going to have an expert, Dr. M. Boston Churchill, Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, St. Joseph's College, Tiruchi. So he is going to deliver his speech on herbal plants conservation through biotechnology technique. Sir has completed his PhD in plant sciences in Bharatdasan University, and the expert area of Boston sir was medicinal plant tissue culturing micro propagation, and sir has published a good number of research papers in reputed journals, and sir has worked experience as landscape architect in Far East Flora Singapore, Kiat Lee Landscape Singapore, Hudson Landscaping Australia. Now sir was currently working as a assistant professor in St. Joseph College. Sir, we welcome you, sir, for this webinar. Over to Boston, sir. Boston, sir.
Sir, Dr. Thyagarajan, thank you so much for your introduction. So before we enter into this webinar series, a lecture, I would like to thank the patron and the chancellor of the Satya Bhama Institute of Science and Technology, Dr. Maria Zina Johnson, and then the president of the same institute, Dr. Mary Johnson, the conveners of this webinar series, Dr. Wilson, the vice chancellor, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, and Mr. Narendra Kumar, and also the organizing secretaries, especially. I would like to thank Dr. Thyagarajan and Dr. Masira Mani Selvam, Dr. Prakash, Dr. Tamil Selvam, and also I would like to give my special thanks to Dr. Justin Koyupullai, the assistant professor of Department of Botany, St. Xavier's College, one who has introduced me here for this webinar series to give this today program. And also other organizing members and the faculties of the Department of Biotechnology, Satya Bhama Institute of Science and Technology. Today, I'm going to deliver a lecture on the topic of herbal conservation through biological techniques. Actually, the two aspects we are going to have a look about the herbal conservation through the biological techniques. The first one is we are going to know about the value and the needs to conserve herbal plants. And also, the second thing is the current important useful tool of the plant tissue culture and how it is useful for the conservation of the rapid propagation of herbal plants. It is expected that the near future, its a plant product is playing the major role in all over the countries, because nowadays you all know very well the medicinal plants, how it is important in our day-to-day life. And each and everyone is depending upon the medicinal plants to live our happy life and healthy life with a good and smiling face, with a healthy life we are living together. Happily we are running our life by using the herbal medicines. Although the evolution of the human civilization is for about the past 8,000 years, past two centuries have brought a great challenges and changes globally. Because now only for the past two centuries, there are so many researches are going on, and also the people have started using medicinal plants for their personal use as well as there are many companies are coming forward to find so much of for the production of medicines from the medicinal plants, herbal plants. So that's why today is increasing awareness towards the herbal plants, medicinal plants, towards increasing the side effects and also the production cost, which is more from the allopathy drugs. People are nowadays looking for taking only the herbal medicines to consuming daily usage. Actually, this medicinal plants has been traditionally recognized throughout the world because it will not be changed to the region wise or the country wise, or globally it is recognized by everyone, and it's having a great informed basis of traditional medicine system has been used for the thousands of years, more than a thousands of years in several countries like India, China and South Africa. There are a lot of evidences that we can have, and I can prove and I can give you that we are the traditional people and we are following the traditional herbal medicine system of following, they're taking our day-to-day life, the herbal medicines. And also the same way, the Chinese and the Africans are also same way they are following of taking the herbal medicines in the day-to-day life. So that's why nowadays, it's worldwide increasing demand for the medicinal plants and medicinal plant-derived medicines. And I'd like to give you a small diversity in India about the herbal plants, how it is diversity in India. It's most probably these medicinal plants are valuable sources, and also it is giving a great knowledge about the medicines and in which way it is used for the foreignness, and also it is useful for the current scenario. And whatever we are upcoming generations also, we have to teach them as a knowledge, as we are learning the knowledge from our foreigners and the researchers and our expertise professors. And what we have learned so far, we are making use of the knowledge to the current society, and also the knowledge in which we are engaging ourselves for the current position, what is the knowledge we are receiving to learn about the herbal plants, and we are going to give the same things to the coming generations. So India is the greatest population over around the world. It is the 12th largest region of following the ancient heritage system, the floristic uniqueness and the rich diversity of the traditional and agriculture and economic plant resources based country we are in. It is a very great proud, as our country is based on the agriculture based people we are all living along with, and having the very pure plant material, derived materials that we are using day-to-day life as a food as well as medicine. And WHO has listed more than 21,000 of plants that they are used as the medicinal around the world. But among that, in India, rich medicinal plants around 2,500 species, of which 1,500 species we are commercially, we are using in the large scale for many purposes. And what is the primary threats of these herbal plants we have nowadays in this, in our country as well as in our lifestyle? The harvest of the medicinal plants on the large scale from the depletion of the plant sources is the very big threat for us, because knowingly or unknowingly, there are many ways the herbal plants are being depleted and exploited by the many sources. Moreover, continuous substantial loss of due to the exploitation of the worldwide several medicinal plants, the species are doing for the past 15 days, we are just coming forward to recover the plants, to conserve the plant, to give more importance and priority for conserving the plant, herbal plants. Plant regions, or wherever it is in the country or worldwide, or wherever the people are doing the research as well as the plant lovers, they are giving more importance for conserving the plant species for just for the past 15 years. There are many cases of rare medicinal plant species under threat because of human interactions. We can say that in the earlier time, nobody who knows and what is the nature of, what is the value of, what is the medicine value which is present in the particular plant, and nobody who knows. Only the traditional followers, medical system followers only who knows. And for this common society, the people, humans are utilizing the land for many purposes, for constructing the buildings, factories, companies, and every day for their personal uses, they are simply exploited, depleted, and destroyed the common healthy herbal land. So this is the way many cause of rare medicinal plant species are also is being become threatened because of human interaction. Hence, their conservation of the plant propagation is very essential among the effective methods. It is the time to conserve and preserve the method, follow the method of conserving the medicinal plants. It is very, very important right now. needs for conservation of the medicinal plants. Why we have to need, what is the need to conserve the medicinal plants? And as I said earlier, the traditional medicines are collected wide range, and if you have been domesticated, and this micropropagation method through the tissue culture, it is an important tool which producing mass multiplication of two type and rare, endemic and endangered medicinal plants. So we may have some knowledge about particular medicinal plants, but most of the medicinal plants value or not yet come to the trial, and which has not been used by many people nowadays. And there are a lot of rare plants, endemic plants, threatened, endangered medicinal plants are need to be conserved in our day-to-day life. The current scenario, we have to put our concentration more and more on that. So therefore, moving it's a poor regeneration efficiency. By using the conventional method, the certain simple methods are being used, like seed germination, stem cutting by the landscapers, horticulturists, and agriculturists. And whatever they are conserving through this conventional method, they can do as much as they can in simplest way. In a very small amount of acres they can do, because of the minimum manual effort what they can put to conserve the herbal plants. But apart from this, potentially important rare medicinal plants is at most very important in many ways. So that all to be conserved, it is very, very important matter that India is across 8,000 acres of the medicinal plants and thousands of species under threatened. Is this matter given by the BSI, Botanical Survey of India, and it is now, it's a great challenge for us. And we have to figure it out. Unfortunately, we may not know it, where it is actually present and where it is all occurring. The very valuable medicine valuable plants, where they are present, where they are occurring, and what are the species which is more, we have to give more priority for it. This and all, nobody knows, and we are not aware of it. So for that, we need to take more action on it to prevent, and we have to conserve the herbal plants. So normally, we all know very well, we are the heritage people. We are following the our forerunner system, our previous generation system, what they followed, the system we are following. And India is a heritage, nothing but following the oldest medicinal traditional system. They followed more than 6,000 medicinal plants are documented as a medicine using across the country. Not only in the field of by the botanists and by the researchers, from the ancestors, by following the yearly system, that we know that how it is being utilized by the people of Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, and Tibetan and Chinese. Moreover, Ayurveda, they are utilizing out of 6,000 medicinal plants, 1,539. Siddha, they are using 758. Yunani, they are using 230. Tibetan, they are using 258. Chinese are using 359. Unknown medicinal plants are using for various purposes. And because most of them are following the traditional system of using the herbal medicines, and they are utilizing these kind of herbal medicines for their many purposes in their life. So the conventional actions are to be taken by the zonal-wise, province-wise, state-wise, national-wise, continent-wise. We have to unite together in this precious time to conserve the herbal medicines, because even whatever the inconvenient or very good, we do not have a very good relationship with the neighboring countries. To protect the nature, to conserve the herbal plants, we should have an amicable relationship with one another, and we should have an action to be taken in the zonal level, in the country-wise, we should have a very good communication to preserve the herbal plants. And as we all know very well, and facing a very big problem nowadays, is a challenge for us to live in this world, whether we will live or whether we will go for, our life will be over. It's a very big question behind a great issue of coronavirus. And a few years back, also we faced a problem, like, the health hazard problem, like chikungunya. For that, our people are advised us to take Nilavembu Kashaya. Is nothing but that helps much for us to get recover from chikungunya. And also nowadays, it's a great problem that the pandemic issue as a COVID-19 of coronavirus is affected throughout the world, not only our country, not only our Tamilians in Tamil Nadu, not only India, is the entire world is now it's closed and it's locked down. And none of the activities that takes place. There is no schools, there is no colleges, there is no research work, there is no agriculture work. Everything, entire world is now it's closed because of only one small virus is playing a vital role. And for that, this also can be, we can get recover from by taking the Tapasura Kudiniri is being advised by many people, especially our government of India and Tamil Nadu research people. They are advising us and guiding us to take this Tapasura Kudiniri. Naturally, we are blessed with the abundant medicinal plants, which provide timely and adequate medicines for several health disasters. And this is one of the health disorders nowadays we are facing. So to get recover from that coronavirus, this Tapasura Kudiniri, which will not get cured from the disease, at least this is now we are taking to get a confident in our lifestyle, as well as definitely this herbal medicines will increase the immune system. By the way of increasing the immune system in our body, we can survive our life very happily. That's all. You know, comparatively with other people, Indians are far better since we are consuming more amount of herbal foods in our day-to-day life. And also we have more strength since we have more immune system, so that we are fight against the pathogen. And we are having so much of confidence that we can get recover from this coronavirus and definitely we can win. It is necessary to understand the correlation among the medicinal herbal immune system of the COVID-19, the present system. And even if it is affected by using these herbal medicines, if we do two important methods of gargling and inhaling of the steam, we can get recovered. That first one is, we'll see, and when I discuss with many people, those who are affected throughout the world, from their statement, I just could find the natural medicines, how it helps really for the people to get recovered from this pandemic issues of the coronavirus being affected entire world. So this is gargling, a small, simple thing which we are following traditionally from our foreigners, from our ancestors, from our family, from grandma, grandpa, appa and amma. We are following the same system. They advised us to take, even whenever we faced so much of these kind of small problems in our childhood, from our childhood, we are doing the thing. And we are supposed to do the same thing to get recover from this current problem, which is arising, which is dominating, which is giving a very big headache, and it is a very big issue the entire world is facing right now. It's nothing but we can do gargling in the morning, in the afternoon, or thrice or four times we can do in a day. We can get relief from sore throat as well. Along with the baking soda mixed with the salt water, we have to do in gargling is nothing but it's in garjanai, or it is in Tamil, koppalipu. Nothing but with the saline water or salt water mixed with the baking soda, if you do the gargling, then you will get some relief, at least for the time being. And as my one of my friend is in Switzerland, and the entire family is affected by this corona. They did nothing. They never admitted in any hospital, and never they get any advice from any doctors. And simply they close their doors and they increase their immune system by taking a very good valuable food materials, as well as they did only these two things, the gargling and the steaming of inhaling and exhaling using the herbal medicines. And then now they got they totally get recover from this corona pandemic issue, and they are still alive in a very good condition. So that we also can follow, it is a good solution for the viral bacterial infection. It can prevent the growth of the yeast and fungi also. So that we are supposed to follow this method. It will be well and good for protect ourselves, prevent ourselves from the infections of the pathogens. Sodium bicarbonate oral rinse, which helps to increase the salivary pH significantly after using the sodium bicarbonate. Oral rinse we can give. There will be a marginal decreased number of bacteria, especially viridans, streptococci, and bacilli species. And also the second one is steam inhaling kasaya. We can, whether we can make use, making use of this, the above below listed medicinal plants, herbal plants, we can inhaling by the method of steaming. It is called, in Tamil, it is called Vedu Pidithavi. Okay, not catching the spirit. One of my friend told me what is the meaning of Vedu Pidithavi in English. I just asked him to find out from dictionary. No, it's catching of spirit. No, it's not like that. It's nothing but steam inhaling and exhaling. When we inhale by using this Asimam Sanctum, Tulasi, Asimam Basilicum, is Thirunitru Pachai, Coleus Aromatics, Omavalli, Kathuravalli, and Solanum Chilobatum, Tuduvelai, Justica Ada Doda, Ada Doda, it's Kurkuma Langa, Turmeric, in Tamil it is called Manjal, and Piper Nigrum is a pepper, black pepper, or Milagu, and Azaradita Indica, Vembu. These are all the things which we are using in our day-to-day life, and from these definitely we can make use of it for steam inhaling and exhaling will surely help us to get recover from the infection of the coronavirus. It is, I'm not saying about very confidently, and I can say very confidently, this is the message I have received from as a statement of cured patient from the coronavirus worldwide. So that not only these are the things, and what are the things or ingredients we are using in our day-to-day life for making sambar, pulikulambu, and rasam also, there are so many ingredients are based on the herbal plants. So whatever we are consuming our day-to-day life as a food, also we can improve our immune system. That's why we are surviving in this world, comparatively with the other countries. We are surviving in a very greatest way, and we are fight against the pathogens of the pandemic corona disease throughout worldwide. Okay, these are the picture. This is the picture we were looking, this tulasi and this kurkuma, you know, and ginger, everything is nothing but it helps to increase the immune system. Okay, so far what we have seen about the importance of the herbal system, importance of the herbal, which is diversity and needs of the conservation of the herbal plants throughout the world. Okay, and there are some disadvantages are also there in the system of following the conventional method. Okay, because nowadays the population is being increased, the human as well as the livestock population have affected the status of wild plants without knowingly or unknowingly or for the personal use, it is being depleted or exploited in an excellent way, in a more way they are spoiling the nature of the God's gift. Okay, so the shortage of herbs also, since they are using more amount of herbs for their personal use as well as for the production of medicines, the shortage of herbs are also right now is a very big problem. And also herbal plants are also made extinct, since they are using enormous amount, large quantities being used by many people throughout the world. Okay, it's a big question for us, it's become extinct. Also, for researchers are well-experienced people, they are knowledgeable people, for their research work, they may use only the medicinal valuable part of the plant, like a particular explant, for example, leaf or flower may be utilized by them in such a way when they use the parts of the plant, herbal parts, which may not affect the entire habitat. But the unskilled laborers, you know, while they collect the plant materials without knowing, they will collect the entire habitat of the plants, so that there will be some sort of exploit to the population, and they may not be available for the coming new generations. You know, our important thing is we have to leave our knowledge. We have to give our knowledge to the people of the next generation. So that is important. So that only the entire world, all the researchers are very, they are spending their valuable time for doing researchers. So that what is the outcome of the doing research? Nothing but after the research is over, we are giving the knowledge to the next generation, so that we have to keep the entire herbal plants for the next generation. So that due to the unawareness of the less education of knowledge of about the herbal plants, the herbal plants are being wasted by unskilled laborers. In this connection, the natural habitats was degraded and loss of plant sources from the habitat in a huge way, an enormous amount. Lot of plants are being wasted. So that all to be conserved. As much as what we can do from our side, we are supposed to do, and we have to take necessary steps and action immediately as a plant lover, as a human being living in the world, and we are facing many problems, many health resource issues there, then and there. So we are supposed to have so much of eagerness, and we are supposed to take immediate action to conserve the herbal plants. So when we have a look of these, all the problems which are arising from the sources, and what is the alternate method? Okay, so the people cannot spend more time. The people, the gardeners, agriculturists, horticulturists, landscape designers, and the plant lovers, students, then botanists. These all the people are how much of the plants they can conserve as much as it's possible for them. They can at least a maximum amount of plants can be conserved by their interest and by the time they are spending, and then for their purpose they can do this kind of work. But actually, in an enormous way, since the world is looking for making use of the economical value of and medicinal value of the herbal plants, only the biological tool of the plant tissue culture is a useful tool for the conservation of the rapid propagation, and it is medicinally important for endangered plants. Now we are going to have a look of the importance of using the biological technical tool through plant tissue culture to conserve the herbal plants through the biological techniques. It is nothing but biological tool. Tissue culture is one of the important tool, and also in the field of biotechnology, conservation of the endangered and economically important plant species can be conserved through this plant tissue culture. And all this commercial use plant tissue culture helps in the large number of production with the minimum cost we can produce. For example, in a medical company or medicine herbal medicine producers may ask you to have enormous amount, a large quantity of plants within the short period of time. That we cannot conserve it, we cannot plant it on the land, and we can give it to them and for economic purposes as well as for the commercial purposes. But it is possible only in the field of plant tissue culture. In a large number of plants can be produced with the minimum cost in the short time of period. That is important. So that when during the comparatively with the conventional method, this is the way this commercial use of for the purpose as well as the plant tissue culture method can be used for the production of the herbal plant materials. So and also not only for the production of plant materials, also what is the importance of the material, of this method, is this technique can be used, and also it is helpful for producing genetically modified crops. That is important. Okay, and also it relies on the fact that many plant cells have the ability to generate as a whole plant. So that capability, if it has, then we can take that plant for the furthermore research. So that this is the way the plant tissue culture plants are being more powerful plants, and it is a very helpful tool to conserve the herbal plants. Okay, so this is one of the micro propagation technique is one of the important, and it is a suitable method for obtaining the large quantity of the genetically homogenized healthy plant material. Okay, tissue culture is an alternate method of the propagating and increasing the availability throughout the year we can do. But otherwise, in the conventional method, we have to wait for the seasonal time, and we have to wait for manual work, and we have to protect the plant from the pests and the infected pathogens, and the droughtness, okay, without getting water, the proper supplying of water, without supplying of proper manure, without supplying of proper nutrients, you know, without proper supplying of pesticides, insecticides. These are all the things we have to protect in the conventional way. But here, this is considerably, we can increase the productivity of the modern crop through this method. So application of the micro propagation helps in crop improvement. Micro propagation protocol can be developed, used for many important medicinal plants. It overcomes the barriers like environment, vegetative propagation. It fulfills the demand of the large scale of cultivation. That's why just now, as I told you, and these are all the things which helps for which helping which helps a scientist to do conservation through the biological techniques of plantation culture. So large scale cultivation we can do. A short period of time is quite enough for the rapid multiplication of mass production of the herbal plants. So we can get mass production, rapid propagation, large scale cultivation, and short period, less economically value. So everything is good. So that's why this plantation culture method is playing a vital role, and it is helpful for in the current scenario for many biological fields lovers as well as the researchers. Today we can speed up an average production of approximately 10,000 times better than the large number of productive plants through the plantation culture. The conventional method, if we produce certain amount of plants within the short period of time, approximately for more amount, average production will be more 10,000 times better. It's more and more large number productive can use through these routine we can have without any disturbances. There need not to wait for any climatic conditions. There need not to wait for any other strategies. We can go for ourselves that we can produce as much as we can through this method. So this is the necessary steps for the conservation and the development of the plants. So plant tissue culture is used for produce genetically identical plants in the absence of fertilization, pollination, and seeds germination. Actually, in the conventional method, we have to wait for these are the things. In absence of the fertilization, in absence of pollination, in the absence of the seed germination, when there is no enough sufficient amount of manures, and the nutrients are in the soil, and when the climatic factor is affects, we cannot go for in a very excellent way to do conserve the plants through the conventional method. But whereas this plant tissue culture method, in absence of genetically identical plants can be produced, even the absence of fertilization, pollination, and seeds germinations. So through this plant tissue culture, we can go for two methods. One is direct organogenesis, and another one is indirect organogenesis with the help of the morass and scoop medium. And what are the ways that we have to follow that we are going to see? And there's a true copy of mother plant we can produce through techniques, and also single room we can produce more than 1 crore number of plants we can produce within short period of time. So what are the steps are to be followed to do this technique, to follow this technique of plant tissue culture? We are going to study about a father of tissue culture, and what is the medium is used for the conservation and medium preparation, a sterilization procedure, direct and indirect method, and standardization and acclimatization. These are all the steps we are going to see one by one. And as you all know very well, the experts, those who are involved in this field, know very well, the father of plant tissue culture is considered to be the German botanist Heberland in the year of 1902. And the medium was prepared by the Morassis and Skoog in the year of 1962. Okay, the medium plant is growth medium is used for the laboratories. Almost this MS medium is being used in the laboratories. And medium was originally formulated and optimized very initially in the tobacco callus biopsy system for facilitating the study with the help of the cytokinins. And it is widely used in micropropagation culture and also callus culture and subculture of all the suspension culture, callus culture, everything, in all the fields it is being used. And also this medium of value will be maintained to get a completely dissolved when we use the particular microsols and macrosols. And we have to go for heat the stable supplement by using the autoclave. And also we have to make up the value up to the, with the help of the distilled water. And we have to adjust the pH value and using the NaOH and HCl. And the plantation culture is generally sterilized by the autocloving. All the explants are supposed to be sterilized. Explants are to be sterilized by using the running water for more than 30 minutes, around 20 to 30 minutes, and mercury chloride using 2 to 3 minutes or 3 to 5 minutes. It depends on the plant. We're supposed to sterilize it before we go for inoculating the plant. The time is required for sterilization depends upon the volume of the medium in the vessel we are going to making up now for maintaining a certain level. And also the laminar airflow chamber we are supposed to use for inoculating the explants. And this will helps to protecting the air through the filtration, the system of exhaling across the work surfaces from the laminar airflow chamber. Unidirectional air system will be there so that the unwanted air will not enter inside, and then the chamber will not become contaminated, and the medium and explants will not be contaminated, so that we can very carefully under the flame of the fire, we can introduce the explants into the medium so that we can get a pure results from that. Otherwise, if we are not following any one of the mistakes if you do following this system, then definitely you cannot get very good results. Definitely the plant material will be infected by the viral bacterial infections will be there. So that they provide an excellent clean air environment for a number of laboratory requirements. It is laminar airflow chamber is one of the important one for the inoculation. The sterile explants are carefully, it will be transferred to the test tube or will be the sustainable container, whatever it is. And then the older system, they followed the cotton flux to cover. And now the technology is since developed, there are so many companies are supplying a very good, luxuriously looks like containers, but it is all very good nature. And it can put on the culture medium with the help of these sterile instruments like forceps, and everything. We can use it. We can make use of the sterile forceps and everything. We can inoculate. So this is called inoculation. And these are the steps that we are supposed to follow. The steps are involved in the micropropagation. The cleaning of the glassware is important. That means that is also to be autoclaved, and we have to clean it up very well. Then preparation of the nutrient medium are to be autoclaved after the preparation. Then after the solidifying, we have to allow it under sterile condition. The selection and sterilization of the explant, we have to sterilize the explants also, as I said earlier. 20 to 30 minutes we are supposed to kept under running water, and we can allow to 2 to 3 minutes or 3 to 5 minutes depends on the explant and families of the plants. We can allow it under the mercury chloride wash. Okay, then inoculation under aseptic explant into nutrient medium, and proliferation of the shoots on a multiplication medium, and it will be go for subculturing again and again. We have to go for transfer the shoots or whatever the explants we are using, and all the explants when the all the growth are supposed to be recorded, a good data are supposed to be maintained. Transferring of the shoots for subculturing again and again, we have to go for subculturing. Then we can, when we change the ranges of ratios of the cytokinins and auxins, definitely we can get good results. Rooting, then we have to go for hardening. Then actually, finally, the plants will reach the field trials. So these are the methods we have to very strictly follow to get a very good results. Then only this method will be the very shortest method. Otherwise, comparatively, the conventional method would be the better later on. So if you fail to do this following this method exactly, then you cannot get good results. So it's very, very important. And medium preparation, a chart is given here. The major salts and minor salts, the ranges you can get. And sterilization procedure is also heat, radiation, filtration, chemical sterilization. Okay, then everything is there. Okay, explants. We're going to just have a look about the explants for the micropropagation by using the various explants, namely like leaf, worm, and root. Any explant can be used for the micropropagation. And this especially medium, cytokinin is consists of BAP, kinetin, and ADS, inosin disulfide. Either individually we can use, or with the combination also we can use with the axin, NAA, IAA, IBA, and gibberellic acid. Okay, for direct and indirect organogenesis respectively. And this is nothing but a picture shows about the explant sterilization. We have to sterilize everything. The instruments we have sterilized, glassware we have sterilized. What are the materials we are going to use? That all supposed to be sterilized. The important thing is this explant, and what we are going to inoculate, that explant also should be sterilized by using the sterilization procedure. Then organogenesis. What is organogenesis? As we all know very well, there are two methods we are going to follow. One is the direct organogenesis, another one is indirect organogenesis. The direct organogenesis is the generation of this helps to identify to the parental plant. Identically, it is parental plant, and whereas the indirect organogenesis, the primary explant is induced from the callus. It will not be directly we can get, through the callus only we can get. This is the difference between the direct organogenesis and indirect organogenesis. Normally, the plant's production through the organogenesis can be achieved by two methods. One is emergence of adventitious. The organs can be directly from the explants can be introduced. That means the organs can be collected directly from the explant, and then we can go for whatever the medicinal value in which the plant is existing. I mean, for example, some plants may have the medicinal value in the leaf. Some plants may have the medicinal value in the root and the flowers, for example. You know, whatever it is, your purpose, for what purpose you are doing, and the purpose can be fulfilled by selecting the explants. And you can select the explant and you can introduce directly that particular organ into the culture medium. You can inoculate it. So this is directly, since you are using this method, is direct organogenesis. And this callus formation, this is organogenesis through the callus formation, is the de novo method, or gene. This means it is nothing but indirect organogenesis. We are not introducing, even we put the organ directly, then actually we have to make ready the medium preparation for the formation of the callus. From the callus, then we can get another primary explant to introduce from the callus. So that these are the two way, the emergence of the adventitious and organogenesis of callus through the formation of the NAVO origin of indirect organogenesis. And this is the laminar airflow chamber, inoculation of explants at laminar airflow chamber. Before we enter into the chamber, sit in the chamber. A chamber is also to be sterile, and also we have to sterile ourselves by using the spray and all. We have to cover with a mask and head cover, the overcoat, and our foot. Everything we have to sterile ourselves to get prevent of the pathogens simply enter into the culture medium containing the tubes and containers. Direct, we are going to have a look about the direct organogenesis. Genetically identical copies of the organ we can get from through this micropropagated. Then, excuse me. See, this procedure is, explant is established to the new nutrition medium containing the moderate level of the auxin and the cytokinin. And subsequently, it can be utilized for the shoot development. And later on, for the shoot culture, this has been established in a numerous species of higher plants by the direct organogenesis. And this is a picture. What you are looking is used, the explant used is the leaf. Then you can see the shoot initiation from the leaf explant. B and C and D is the high frequency of the shoot proliferation, and the final one is hardening. These are the stages we are supposed to observe the growth of the plants from the initial stage to the final stage. The all the growth should be recorded, and it should be documented for further calculation and comparison. In recent years, this has been increased. An interest on in vitro culture techniques, offers of the viable, rare and endangered threatened medicinal plants can be conserved through this method. So that it has been lot of interest has been increased in this field recently. So auxin is supplement NAA, indolensic acid and anthelenic acid, indolutic acid production. That you can trial, you can have a trial. The ranges will be differ according to the explant as well as according to the family, according to the members of the family. Also, it will be vary from one another. So that there is no constant value for each and everything, whether it is for mass propagation or shoot proliferation or root production or callus formation. There is no constant value which has been given by anybody else. We have to record it and by the knowledge, by the experience, we will become expertized in this field every day, this and this work without accounts. That calculus. So what you are looking is the stages of the explants in the form of numbers. Whatever the hormones you used are date, the things which you would like to note down over there, informations to get, you can get out of it. So that from the beginning, you are supposed to do in a prompt way that will help you to do in a greatest way of calculation for the confirmation of the record value. Then what you are looking is direct arborosmosis is the internode explant is used, and you can have a look here. The shoot incision from the internode explant. The C and D is the high frequency of the shoot proliferation, the rooting of the regenerated shoots, and then finally hardening. You can have a look. And the root explant is used here, and the shoot incision. You can have a look of from the picture B. And the rooting of regenerated shoots from C and hardening, and then high frequency also you can see from C and D. Okay, so whatever the explants in which we are using, we can get good results. Based on that, we have to go for more trials. Okay, when we go for keep on more trials, definitely in one combination and one range and one ratio, we can get a good result. That we have to note down, and we can go for. For the analyze, it will definitely help you. And the culture room, this culture room will be like this, and you have to preserve it here to avoid contaminations. And we have to observe daily, and we have to note down the growth and when it is inoculated, when it is back from the subculture, and when it is supposed to go for another subculture, and all the informations we are supposed to record here. And this is also a sterile room. And we are also supposed to enter inside within a sterile condition to get this all the cultured material in an excellent way to maintain in a proper way. We are supposed to maintain in a sterile condition. The plants can be regenerated under organized unorganized callus tissue. It's direct arborogenesis we are going to have a look. We have seen so far the direct arborogenesis, and this is. From the callus only we can get the exogenous applications of the growth regulators. We can get the unorganized callus tissues derived from the different explants. Okay, the formation of the callus from the source of the explant varies depending on the explants in which we are using and the growth regulators in which we are using of the culture medium and etc. So there will not be any uniform result you can get. Okay, but whatever it is vary from one another. Depends on the explants as well as depends on the growth regulators, depends on the culture medium in which we are using, it will be vary from one another. So the calluses are generally, there are two types of calluses, and one is friable callus, induction of the somatic embryogenesis. The friable callus is nothing but induction of somatic embryogenesis. And second one is non-friable callus is nothing but nodular callus, which helps for the formation of the multiple shoot organogenesis. So this is the two way of the two types of organogenesis from the indirect organogenesis. Then this is the picture you are looking. Indirect organogenesis, the node explant is used for the indirect organogenesis. You can have a look of a very beautiful callus formation here, and shoot incision from the nodal explant. And C and D is the high frequency. The leaflets are formed from the callus. and rooting are regenerated, and hardening also you can see. So the formation of both calli, it is depends on the explant sources and by using the growth hormones and also the nutrient medium in which we supplied and what are the nutrient mediums we used for the subculture, and based on that this performance will be there. By using the auxin, moderately but the higher concentration is the primary hormone used for produce callus. We can get callus by using the auxin. In some species, high concentration of auxin and low concentration of cytokine, the medium promotes abundant cell proliferation with the formation of callus. So that this is also a try. So if you go through some literatures, you can get more idea and which is possible and which is relevant, which is yeah, alternate way you can go. Otherwise, the same method you can follow, or which is suitable for which organ, and which is good for a particular family or species. Everything you can get idea by going through certain literatures. You can get idea. And some species of the higher concentration of axidia, the low concentration you can get abundant of the cell proliferation with the formation of the callus. And callus tissue comprises a wide range of cell types. You can have a look here, axillary bud, explant, and the very good formation of the callus from the axillary bud, the high frequency of cell proliferation and hardening finally. This transfer of the callus to continuous supporting of the growth leads to the formation of meristemoids from the growth centers. After the meristemoids are formed, how it will be looks like? It is nothing but it will be localized the condition of the cluster of campium, like cells will be there, and which may become the vascularized due to the appearance of the tracheoidal cells in the center. That all the things we can observe over there after the formation of meristemoids. With the worldwide increasing demand nowadays for the plant derived medicines, there has been a concomitant increase in the demand for the raw material of the herbal plants, so that it is good to know about and continuing the conservation of the herbal medicines through the biological techniques of plant tissue culture. And here you are looking the explants were used, the root explants were used, and shoot initiation of the shoot explant you can see, and rooting are regenerated from the shoots and hardening. So after that, from the growth is reached, then suppose the plants are supposed to be transferred from the medium to the when we compost container containing consists of the container, then we can observe under the room temperature greenhouse, then we can transfer the things to the hardening, and we can after this we can have a trial for some times, then we can take the things to the normal level. And there are furthermore studies we can go for somatic embryogenesis. We can get there are a lot of stages. We can get globular, heart, torpedo, dicotyledony can be observed, liquid medium containing cytokine and auxin. With the help of this, we can. What is the importance of using following this method is we can get frequencies of the roots from this method by using the IBA. Okay, auxin IBA, we can make use of it for the progressive research. To get progress results of for the production of roots, we can get, we can make use of it. Actually, the somatic embryogenesis helps for the long time storage is called cryopreservation. And these are the stages of things you can have. The globular stage, heart stage, torpedo stage directly, that the stage you are looking here. And this is the result is received from a plant. And these are the stage you can have. If you go for a very good trial, if you follow the system from the beginning in a good way, you can get the same result. And also another thing is in vitro flowering. And this is also one of the important tool to get a pure line selection of the material. So in vitro flowering was generally introduced. Plant gets cultured medium supplemented with the GA3. When GA3 is supplemented, you can get very good flower will be initiated. Then you can have a look here of the flower, how it is initiated by using the GA3 medium. And you can see the stages, various stages. And also there are supporting studies are also we can go for to confirm our studies. The varieties in which we have received from the mother plant as well as through the direct and indirect tarpenogenesis, whether which one is competent, which one is good, which one is the characteristically it is good whether the chemical constituents which are present inside the mother plant as well as in the organizer is plant. If you want to have a comparison also, you can go for RAPD work, molecular RAPD work, and antibacterial and antimicrobial work, you know, and antioxidant work, and phytochemical studies we can go for, and what are the chemical constituents which are present over there, that we can have a look through this. And phytochemical analysis can be performed to confirm the presence of the quantity, how much of quantity of the phytoconstituents is in the explant. Particular explant, if you want to know that chemical constituents which are present in particular explant, also you can go through this GCMS study. That will help you to know the medicinal value and the medicinal properties and the chemical constituents, the phytochemical constituents which are present in the explants, that you can go for analyze and you can get a very good idea about particular plant plants. Okay, and so finally, through this technology of the biological technology of tissue culture, we can survive, we can conserve the plants comparatively with the conventional method. It is being well and good to conserve the plant, herbal plants throughout the world. And this is the way we are conserving is it's not only for our purposes, and we have to lead the way, and we have to give our knowledge of the studies, what we have learned and what we are engaging ourselves with in the research, that we have to give for the coming generation, new generations, our followers. We have to give, we have to educate, that only they will have some kind of idea to have their good life. So that this kind of doing a good study, which definitely helps for the current researchers as well as to conserve the herbal materials throughout the world.
Thank you, sir.
Happily, we can have a very good life. We can make use of all the medicinal valuable herbal plants. Thank you, Thomas, sir, for this so much, the organizers and all the team members. Thank you, one and all, patiently sir. Listening so much so far. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. Sir, we have a few questions, sir. Yeah, that was a wonderful presentation, and yeah. There were many participants saying that it was an informative and more picturesque presentation. Thank you for that, okay. Sir. And okay, one sir. Of the common questions that people have in mind is that now medicinal plants are readily available in my place. Why should it be cultivated using tissue culture?
Whatever you have, it will be deployed and be wrongly used by the unskilled liaising the medicinal plants in a wrong way. That you cannot conserve the entire habitat in your place. How long you can keep? For the time being, where until you are there, you can preserve, you can conserve the material. Unless if it is lost, it will be the great loss for the society, for the nature also. So that we have to preserve it and conserve it in a huge number of population. So it will be helpful for us as well as for the upcoming generation. So we have to do this conservation through the biological techniques.
Sir, and another question that people ask is there a market for this herbal medicine in India, sir?
Herbal medicines, no. Actually, everybody is taking effort. Now, for example, in Trichy, our college, we have 4 centers. We have Shepherd office, that means a program, that there we have a herbal garden. And research in our department, we have our own garden. And there's another garden in the another Rabinat Herbarium. There we are maintaining. And the college residence or father's residence we are maintaining. And the college campus we are maintaining. So everywhere we are maintaining. So we are, people are having, they are selling so many herbal plants. But since we are putting more effort to conserve it, we can go for sales also. We are in planning, actually, from our college. We are in planning. We are going to do this. We are going to sell medicinal plants as a marketing. We are going to do. We are selling right now. We are selling in a small scale. And very soon, we will elaborately, we will extend our department production of the medicinal plants. And we will go for the commercial purpose also very soon.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the elaborate presentation. And I am an alumni of St. Joseph's College, sir, so happy to have you with us. Thank you very much.
And very happy to know you, sir.
To the participants, for any queries regarding herbal plants, or you want to have any plants, medicinal plants, you can contact Dr. Bastian, so from St. Joseph's Trichy. So he'll be happy to help you in this regard. Thank you, one and all, for participating today. And tomorrow's session will be the last session in this lecture series. And what more can we demand than having Dr. S. Ravikumar, who will be talking on digital droplet PCR and its application in times like COVID, where PCR is widely known to even the common man. So we have another new concept of using digital droplet PCR and its application in the field of medicine. Looking forward to having you tomorrow. Thank you. Thank you for the session. Thank you, sir, once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for yours.